caution.
What is that?
Manual caution.
All right. I turned it off. It's me and the good Lord flying the airplane.
Welcome back to Boys Bible Study. We have turned the autopilot off, y'all. It's just us and God flying this podcast right now. And we couldn't be happier. We're back. It's Ash. I'm here with
Scott.
And Julian. And Delta Niner. J. What's the J one?
Jazz,
salami.
Yeah. Alpha Zulu Julian Scott Ash. We 999. Come in. Your podcast has dipped dangerously low in
ratings.
We need
you to pull up. We need you to pull up on the Patreon. Yeah.
Okay, that volume knob right by you. I need you to turn that all the way up. Well. We could not be happier this week to be talking about a brand new Christian film, hot off the presses, poised to be the Christian media event of the year. When I watched it today, Amazon Prime claimed it was the number one movie on the service currently. Make of that what you will. And this is the brand new Christian film, On a Wing and a Prayer, which, it's always very exciting when we get to be a part of, the zeitgeist, the Christian zeitgeist. We don't always do that. We like to dip into the past as well. But here we are, flying on a wing on a prayer and by the seat of our pants right here.
Just before we get too deep into it, did either of you think that it was crazy how this movie had worse special effects than the Judas Project, which came out like almost 40 years ago?
Hey, those were award-winning special effects.
Yeah,
that's true. They did have some pretty quality special effects guys working on that.
They did. Bill Burr, I want to say, was somebody's name. I'm vaguely remembering from listening back to the episode. The Judas Project is that's setting a really high bar, even for Christian cinema. But I don't know. Special effects get me. I'm very much like a moviegoer that's like, oh, wow, how'd they do that?
I
didn't really mind
like
the
shit.
Yeah,
it looked like a PlayStation 2 cutscene for like whenever the plane was flying in.
You have to do a quick time event to pull up on the throttle. You have to do a quick time event to stab your sister with an EpiPen or else she dies of a peanut allergy.
Spoilers.
Oh, yeah. Well,
yeah.
Hey, this is based on true events. I can't spoiler the reality.
Yeah. If you haven't seen the movie yet, skip over that last thing that Ash just said. Mm-hmm.
Well, On a Wing and a Prayer, like I said, brand new, hot off the presses, released on Amazon Prime this week.
Just a couple days ago.
Yeah, I was going to say just a couple days ago.
Yeah.
Do you know how I literally first heard about this movie? I'm pretty sure we might have been sitting in the same room, Julian, but it was because of the internet personality Mind of Jason posted about it.
No.
Okay, maybe I was with Tom and Woodrow. I can't remember, but Mind of Jason for...
It's pronounced Jason.
Yeah, I can't help but say Jason. Because
I don't know.
Because
he
spells it like the letter J S O N. I'm sure his name literally is just Jason, but like you can't help but read it as Jason because that's how he's continually referred to online.
That's funny.
But he is this for anyone listening who does not know who he is. He is this insane like outsider internet personality in a way that you didn't think could exist since like the 2000s. And basically, what he does is he gets really high and drunk and cooks the most disgusting meals and with the hashtag real men cook. He famously made that meme. He makes memes with pictures of his own face in them. And there's the one that's like, I'm fucking stealing something out of your house. That's like a Jason meme. He makes the meme that says it's just a picture of his face smiling. And it says Jewish pussy got me acting strange.
Wow.
Anyway, he's a famous internet meme figure, and he has really insane taste in movies. Every movie he watches, he posts about and says it's the best movie ever. And he made let me just find his On a Wing. No, you know what? I'll never be able to find it because he posts like 50 times per day, and they're all deranged. But I just remember he posted something about On a Wing and a Prayer like 3 days ago, and it was like, I know this movie gonna make me cry. Like exclamation points. And it was just like the still of this. So, you know, shout outs to Jason. Like there's very few people who I would consider like influencers in my internet life. But he's one of them. So that's how I first heard of this movie.
After he posted that, 10 minutes later, he said, never mind, they found the EpiPen.
Yeah. Yeah. Honestly, if you ever tasted his cooking, you'd probably need an EpiPen too, even if you don't have an allergy of some kind. Really, you should. His cooking is like a Google Deep Dream.
Ugh.
It's incredible.
Oh my God.
Faces in it.
I am Mind of Jason. I believe this is his. You know, he's always getting like banned and having to re. Oh, it's Mind of Jason right now on Twitter. He tweets like blacked out. Like he, a post from 7 hours ago, he just took a photo of a woman on the bus and wrote cute ass chick on the bus.
Wow.
It's just like what wow. He posted. He 29 minutes ago. I don't know if he's blacked out. Show set, food set. Thanks, Baber. I know you go and read this, make another pate just like did chicken curry and rice. I'll spell that as one word. With a picture of a disgusting looking bowl of like meat and rice. He's incredible. So anyway, on a wing on a prayer and a prayer fan, my Mind of Jason endorses the movie. How did you guys hear about this? Was it just like the Christian internet sphere?
I think I just saw an ad on television.
Honest. Prime's really pushing it. Like when I loaded up Prime to watch this, it was like the top option. I did not have to look at all.
Okay.
Right there.
Well, like I said, apparently it's the number one movie, but they're really forcing it down everybody's throats. But
I mean, they timed it with Easter weekend too and claimed that this happened on Easter weekend, which I assume is true. I just didn't look it up.
Oh, that's interesting. That's right. I remember that from the beginning of the episode, but yeah, of course they timed it with Easter weekend. I will say just overall, I mean, we're about to get into the whole movie, but I thought this movie was fun. Like a lot of the new Christian movies have a tendency to just drag and drag. Like anything from the last 5 or 6 years has just such boring parts to it, even if it has a promising premise. Like that horrible one where the guy from Riverdale was like the singer songwriter.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, we reviewed that a couple years ago, but that movie was like, God, there was some great, I mean, fucking Shania Twain was in that movie and it still sucked.
Yeah.
Right.
This movie was punchy. Like I liked it. It was entertaining. It was a pretty good, like Easter weekend blockbuster streaming era blockbuster.
Yeah. I mean, the plot actually moved.
Right.
As ridiculous as it was.
True.
Right.
Well, that's what you get from director Sean McNamara.
Yes. Sean McNamara, most notably a producer on Disney Channel.
Yeah, he did direct some Disney Channel movies. He did a number of the Baby Geniuses sequels.
Very cool.
That would have been a fun extra tie-in for this movie if they had like some, because you know they added in the EpiPen part. If they had some babies being involved helping save the day, that would have been.
And
fun.
They could talk, and they got the babies got on the radio and helped talk.
Yeah,
down.
Yeah. They that don't even realize awesome. He's talking to a baby the whole time because it's just on the phone.
I mean, I thought that's what was going to happen when they had the kids following the mm-hmm. flight.
What's wrong? What's the emergency?
I don't have an emergency. I'm listening to one.
Who's that talking?
Air traffic chatter. This guy's got a dead pilot on board.
No way. How do you know?
These are all the planes in the air right now, and this is the plane that we're following. My dad showed me how to use the sight. It's how I track him when he's flying.
This is happening right now.
Yeah, with a slight delay.
And somebody's about to crash?
It's possible.
What were those kids there for? Do you think they added those kids in after the movie was finished?
I kind of think so, because I was wondering the same thing at the end of the movie. Like, what was the point of all that?
Yeah, I sort of, my theory was that the kids watching were sort of like the audience stand-in slash they, you know, we got another like little inspirational thing of like the girl who wants to be a pilot, but I felt like they were supposed to be like audience. Like they would frequently just re-explain the plot in like dumber terms.
Oh my yeah. God. This movie was like someone would say something and then it would be repeated 8 more times yeah. right after someone said it. It was so crazy.
Well, quick before we move on though, I just wanted to add that Sean McNamara was the executive producer of very popular television shows, Even Stevens, That's So Raven, and Phil of the Future.
Wow.
He produced tons of episodes of all of those shows, which is like, those were like some of the biggest shows at that time for kids. So
yeah,
he absolutely, he can make something punchy, I think.
Yes. And he did a Jim Varney movie that I haven't seen. He did Treehouse right. Hostage in 1999, which is probably a Disney movie.
Is it? I was reading one of the reviews. Didn't that say that was like Jim Varney's last movie and that like really? He was like coughing up blood on set or something?
Oh my God.
I'm not familiar with Jim Varney. Oh, Ernest. Ernest.
Yeah.
Of Ernest. Course. Ernest.
Wow.
And he also, Sean McNamara also directed Soul Surfer, Orphan Horse.
Wow.
The Trial of Old Drum, which is about an orphan dog. He did an orphan horse movie and an orphan dog movie. The orphan dog gets put on trial because they wrongfully blame it for murdering a sheep. It's kind of interesting.
What? Is okay. this? Does this take place in fucking like ancient Sumerian times where they would like, like put like, know. You know, camels on trial for witchcraft or something?
Maybe. Haven't seen it. But he also, I was really happy because he directed the Bratz movie, which at least according to many Letterboxd users I follow is excellent. So it was a good reminder. I still need to watch that.
Wow. What's the Jim Varney movie called?
Treehouse Hostage.
Treehouse Orphan.
Yeah, unfortunately, Jim Varney died mid-production during Treehouse Hostage, and so Sean McNamara had to actually had to pilot his part.
Oh my God!
They had to tell the kids how to move his body.
Jeez,
very sad. Sorry.
I know. I started it. R.I.P. for real. I love the Ernest movies.
Oh yeah, no, dude. Of course, he's a legend. I just, you know, we just watched a movie about a fucking pilot dying in midair. It's like,
yeah.
They gave it away in the trailer. Did y'all watch the trailer?
Yeah,
yeah. I know it's based on the premise.
Story, yeah, I know that's the thing with this movie. So gentle listener, if you're living under a freaking rock here, what are you gonna say?
Just the based on a true story thing is so funny.
It's so
it is.
Good.
You can look up this incident. Did either of you look up the incident? Like they
Not
have
really.
The audio logs and like people recreating it because it's such a famous thing in the world of flying. I want you to guess how long the actual flight was.
20
the
minutes.
The actual okay, you got it.
Really?
It was
really?
20 minutes, yes.
Did the guy actually die?
The entire incident was 20 minutes. The pilot did actually die, and the guy was actually, like, talked into flying the plane. But he, like, knew lingo.
1/7000, just try to keep the plane level at 1/7000.
I just started speaking air traffic control just a few days ago, so if you could just speak a little slower and in English.
Roger that. I mean, sure thing.
He knew the flying lingo. He knew how to fly like a smaller aircraft, like more so than they were doing in the movie.
Yeah.
Right.
They added a lot into this movie to drag okay. it out to the hour and 40-minute yeah. runtime.
Yeah, you could have literally filmed this happening in real time and still had like an entire half hour before and after the incident.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, still a very impressive thing that happened. But yeah, man, did the guy fucking just like die as soon as they took off, I guess?
Yeah, I guess he had a heart attack.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, while ascending, they said he lost consciousness.
I'm sorry to jump ahead, but just to mention at the very end credits when they're like showing everybody's like real faces who did yeah. it, and they end on the pilot who died. All I couldn't help think was, "Yeah, thanks for nothing, asshole."
Yeah, I was like, wow, that's what I was thinking too.
Yeah, it's like everyone else, like, what a hero, and then
yeah.
the guy who fucking started all this shit by not being able to keep it together for one flight.
It was also really funny to me when they would show like the one air traffic controller who was a black guy. And then they would like show his real life person and it was just a white guy. It was just really funny when they would like dissolve between those.
That
it reminded me of that casino commercial that they have out here where it like changes from like a sexy woman of Asian descent into like an old man wearing like a football jersey.
It'd be like data moshing like a showgirl into a senior citizen for no reason. Off-putting. Weird and off-putting. Yeah, they've been showing it on all like it's like on Tubi and stuff.
Yeah.
They keep showing these like casino commercials. Yeah, where a beautiful bikini babe gets data moshed into like
someone the Morongo the Morongo casino commercial.
It's really cool. They also did that. I don't know if you noticed with the woman who worked the control room. She was also a white woman who was recast as a black woman for the movie. So, well,
not that there's anything wrong with it. It was just funny to see those images like side by side in a Christian movie.
Totally, yeah.
Because you know, people are. Never mind. I was gonna accuse other people of thinking the same thing I thought. Only they have malicious intent when they think about it.
Mm-hmm. Right. Right, right. Well, the road to hell is paved with malicious intentions.
That's what they say.
So they say, well, on a wing and a prayer. Star-studded cast. Big shout-outs to our girl, Heather Graham. Very excited to see her in this film.
Yes.
Who, you know, there's many things that you might know her from, but I definitely love her iconic role in Boogie Nights. That's definitely like the first thing I think of. And of course, in the lead role, we have Dennis Quaid as, what's this guy's name? Walter White? Don White?
Doug White.
Doug White. Yeah. Dennis Quaid as Doug White. And I'm kind of surprised Dennis Quaid hasn't been in more Christian movies.
He was in another one, I think, too. He's playing Ronald Reagan in some movie out too.
Was the guy go inside of in Inner Space a Christian?
Yeah, he goes inside Martin Short, who is a devout Christian in that movie. He's Christian in Clifford. At the end, he's a priest.
Good enough for me.
So, yeah.
Well, you know, in his like current age, he's 69.
Yes.
I mean, he looks really good for 69, but you know, he's like a senior citizen now. And in his current like age, he is the perfect Christian male lead. You know, Christian movie male lead, because he's like, you know, handsome, white, you know. Yeah. Like can convincingly do a sort of suburban everyman who flies planes as a hobby. Like that's like a role that would be very easy for him just by looks alone.
Yeah.
To play. Although, you know, he's a very good actor. I know he can do more difficult stuff too, but like, you know, it's, I'm surprised. Oh my God. I'm blanking on the famous actor who's in, the Colton Burpo movie.
Greg Kinnear.
Yeah. Like Greg Kinnear served that exact same function in the Colton Burpo film. You know, again, just like famous Hollywood actor who it's very easy to like cast in the role of like the white suburban Christian patriarch. Yeah. So shout outs to Dennis Quaid.
He's got that. Dennis Quaid's got that like white suburban angst.
Yes.
Sort of going on the way he speaks to air traffic controllers like their customer service the entire movie.
Yeah, it was done really well.
Yeah,
it really was. Also, the way he's always like sweating and grimacing. I mean, I get that it's like frequently because in this movie he's in like the high stress situation of being in an airplane. But I mean, we meet him in the beginning of the movie. He's stressed out in an airplane in his like flying school.
Yeah.
And then, you know, for most of the second act of the movie, he's also stressed out in an airplane. But like his like resting face in this movie is like groaning and covered in sweat.
Yeah.
Which looks sexual. Like, you know. Yeah. Well, just, you know, looks like any 70-year-old white man like trying to eat like, you know, a roast beef sandwich at like your local diner. But you know, I mean, he's doing it way more handsomely than that. But I've got to say that, you know, he and Heather Graham together, it looks so much like the Christian version of the movie Airplane to me.
Yeah.
Like the when the two of them were in the pilot seat, it just like really reminded me of Airplane. Like the whole time I couldn't stop thinking about like all the jokes from Airplane happening in the context of this movie.
Oh my God, you're right. Like imagining her like pushing over the dead pilot and then the plane nosedives. Like that's
yes. No, it was just like Airplane. And, you know, she kind of like looks like Julia Hegarty a little bit. I mean, maybe not really, but they're both just like, you know, pretty and have long, straight hair and, you know, sort of like easygoingness. And it's just I couldn't not help but think of like all the shenanigans that would ensue if this was a Zucker movie. Why can't the Zuckers do a conservative Christian plane crash movie?
Well, they did that conservative Christian movie.
Right, but they,
but
should
they
do,
didn't have a plane crash.
They should do Christian Airplane. This is what I'm pitching to them.
Yes.
Off the success of On a Wing and a Prayer, why can't we get Dennis Zucker back in the stew to make On a Wing and a Prayer 2?
Expect turbulence.
Yeah, that's great. On a Wing and a Prayer 2, expect turbulence. I love it. Yeah, we'll get the Zuckers in there. Also in the movie, Jesse Metcalfe, who we actually had in God's Not Dead 2.
He played,
there's many actors
John
in that
Tucker
movie.
Must Die.
Yes, John Tucker Must Die, he was famous for. I didn't really watch any of these shows, but if you look at his IMDb, it's clear that he's most known as a TV actor. He was in many episodes of the soap opera Passions. He was also in Desperate Housewives.
Oh, he was in Passions? I like
yes,
that soap opera.
Yes, he was in Passions.
I watched that regularly for a little while.
That's like the weird one, right?
Yeah.
Yes, that's the
like
weird
aliens
one.
Aliens and shit.
Yeah, there's like a witch in it and like a doll boy.
Cool.
Yeah, that is the one that when I would like catch it on TV, I would sit around and watch it.
He was also in that Dallas reboot that happened in the 2010s. So those are our biggest stars. And of course, everyone looks great. And everyone's playing real life people. These are all real life characters that they're portraying. Yeah. How do we meet our all-American family? How do we meet the Whites, literally, as this movie opens up?
Doug White and his brother are flying what do they call that kind of plane?
A Cessna.
Oh, the Cessna. Yeah. They're flying a Cessna and it's like a bumpy landing. And then the family gathers together to participate in a chili cook-off.
Yes.
Which had a very funny judging scene.
Yes, it did. Talk about that. Those are the best parts of this movie.
Yeah.
The best part of this movie is not even like the overarching plot, which is like pretty predictable, but the best part is like the details, like the random shit they added and the random shit we see this family depicted
just
as
the
doing.
Stupid fucking lines where like the judge was like, what's your name and what do you do? And he's like, I'm a dentist or something? He was some fucking
a
rich
pharmacist.
White guy.
A pharmacist.
Yeah, the kind of job you get where you like fly planes is just for fun.
Right.
Yeah, he's like, I'm a pharmacist with a chili cooking hobby. And the judge is like, well, this little hobby of yours just won you the chili cook-off, which they fucking did the same thing at the
ending. I was thinking this too. This movie loved doing the trope where someone starts talking to you and they act very disappointed and then they turn it into a compliment. Imagine if your average person just did that to you. Imagine if I was like, you know, Julian, what were you thinking of your performance on the podcast today? And you're like, because you just became the best podcast co-host ever. I don't know. Some stupid shit like that. What if that's how people talk to each other?
Well, speaking of how people talk to each other, they sounded so fake from the South, that whole scene, everybody talking.
Yes.
It's like you are all just Hollywood actors. Could you make that more clear to me right now?
It was interesting the way that, like, you know, conservative culture was affected in this movie, because again, we live in the era of aesthetics. Like that's all there is. Like no culture basically is real anymore. So, you know, certainly not like any American culture, which is all like affectation, but it was just like, yeah, we had the family, we had them in like the barbecue contest, you know, we had them, there, you know, it'd be shots of like people like pouring beers in bars and like listening to like, you know, middling like country music.
Yeah.
But that's all there really is. Like, we're all just like, everyone in the world, especially the United States, is basically just like a liberal affecting like whatever little shred of identity that you are.
Yeah. Well, they did have the important thing in their culture was playing trash basketball or whatever.
Yes.
Remember that? That went on for so long. They had to have like every single member of the family do something. And then the one girl being like, I don't want to play. This is stupid.
I don't want to play trash basketball. Yeah. It's like, wow, you so fucking funny bitch. He was get your ass like, out there.
Dennis Quaid was like, oh, let me shoot a free throw. And then Heather Graham was like, how about I shoot a three pointer? And then the one daughter was like, I'm going to go for a dunk.
2 points for Terry.
That was a three-pointer. Oh, no, no. Get that charge out of here.
Really? Come on.
And how many points for a dunk?
It's like they're like going to play a full-on fucking game of throwing like trash away.
Yeah.
That is hilarious.
Yeah, and then the one daughter who is portrayed as a stuck-up bitch the entire movie. Yeah. It's just like, yeah, throwing trash is gay. She does not say that, but, you know, and they give her the Meg Griffin effect.
Yeah.
The whole time.
It was funny that she didn't want to throw trash. Like, she didn't want to throw trash away. And like, she walked away and her mom like runs up and it's like, hey, what's wrong with you today?
Yeah,
she said, I don't want to hang out with disgusting homeless people all morning.
Right.
Because they just come from feeding the homeless their leftover chili.
Right.
Their leftover five-alarm chili.
Yeah. Heather Graham said, the next time I throw you an alley-oop, you better toss it on home. Like, what do you think? What are the writers
exactly
thinking alley-oop
goes down?
Yeah, exactly. I guess I don't know trash basketball that well, though.
Yeah, the rules are a little different. The three-point line's closer.
Yeah. Yeah, I love that line. Yeah, when I throw you an alley-oop, you better toss it in. And then she's like, what you're supposed to say is, yes, ma'am. I did not really think about how important trash basketball is to this family. I obviously, you know, this is supposed to be like a micro scene that represents how they all have this like very tight family dynamic, except for the one daughter.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which
also does not really come into play at all for the rest of the movie.
No. It's supposed to be like, of course, believe it or not, when you're in like a near-death experience with your family, then, you know, it brings everyone closer together. Like, it's almost as if they were going to build up for like, no, the daughter, like the other girl wouldn't help her sister when she needed her EpiPen in the plane. It's like, of course she's gonna help her sister. Like, just because she has a bad attitude sometimes doesn't mean she's like an evil person. I felt bad for her character during this movie.
Yeah,
like,
and they were like, made her all scared because they were like, oh, you have to go to the back of the plane, and she's like, the back of the plane. Get the EpiPen
back.
And also, I mean, I know we're getting really far into it, but it was like, it seems like you would like know how to do an EpiPen, how to use an EpiPen if your sister was deathly allergic to peanuts.
That whole thing was ridiculous. The fact that they would be in this crisis situation on the plane and she casually eats a chocolate candy bar as a teenager without reading the label, having allergies her whole life, and then the other one doesn't know how to use an EpiPen and is scared to do it. Like, get the fuck out of
psycho.
Here. That was awesome.
And she says, this is going to hurt me a lot more than it hurts you, right before she gives her the EpiPen. And she's like, dude, she's passed out, and all you have to do is like stick this thing in her leg.
Yeah.
It's like, but the fucking thing with the peanuts was that she read the label and it said, this candy bar is made in a factory that also processes peanuts and tree nuts and stuff.
Right.
That's literally on every single thing.
Every single thing.
It doesn't mean that it's cross-contaminated. It's like they legally have to put it on there.
Right. So you can't.
Oh, it did this time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Of course. Yeah.
Unless it was placebo effect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it did take them 10 minutes to get, like, I looked at the timestamp. So it was 10 minutes to get the EpiPen.
I'm deathly allergic to placebos, actually. again, yeah, Maggie, even similar in name to Meg Griffin. But, you know, it's one of those things. It's self-defeating. So, okay. So, yeah, the daughter maybe isn't as interested in some of the family cultural things that the rest of them are. But the whole movie, they're like, there's a direct line. Maggie is just different than Bailey. You know, Bailey is like ready to be out, be like, my uncle's going to win the barbecue contest.
Yeah.
And Maggie's like, I actually just kind of want to talk to my friends. And they're like, you fucking slut, get in the van and take these dishes that you throw in the trash in the basket. You have fun.
It's that's fucking Christian movie thing of like, you have to love your family. You have to do everything as a family unit, and you all have to be like best friends too.
Yeah, there's two types of teenage girls. Perfect Bible study goers who do everything right how their parents want them to, and harlot Jezebels.
Yep. And, you know, again, these are based on real girls as well.
Yeah.
They like showed their pictures at the end.
This movie was a fucking hit job on a lot of real people.
I know.
Like the air traffic controllers.
Right.
I felt like this was extremely disrespectful to the people who actually helped really land the plane.
Yeah, like the one is like, okay, this guy's a fucking drunk.
Yeah.
this guy was a drunk.
And there's like always
breaking
like
aviation laws.
They're like, take forever to respond to any of his pleas for help. And they're like, oh, what do we do? What do we do? Yeah, we've never like, done anything like this like, before.
And then they're like, we'll be right back with you. And they're like, okay, this we agree that this guy's going to fucking die. Right?
Yeah, yeah. Every time.
We're sending him
like,
to the ocean, right?
Yeah. He's like, please help me. What do I do? And they're like, we have to bring this fucker down right away.
Yeah. So
that was the implication, right? They were trying to send him out to, I was kind of tuning in and out, but they were like trying to send him out to the ocean
at
to
one
crash.
Point. Yes. Yeah. You know, it's funny because they kind of like resolve. They didn't really like say when that changed, but at one point the, you know, little girl pointed out and the one like the more like hardline aviation controller.
Yeah.
The, you know, the little girl who was interested in aviation, who was eavesdropping on the radio signal. She was like, yeah, they're going to, I've seen this in airplane documentaries. They're going to send him in the ocean so that everyone on the plane dies.
No survivors.
Yeah.
Like and, basically setting it up for like a false flag thing.
Yeah. And like they were basically portraying everyone in the air traffic booth as it's like, you know, like letting a dog run away before you like shoot at it, being like, go on, run toward the sunset. Go on, Hunter. And then just like, you know, with a tear in your eye, they're like, yeah, turn left at 060 degrees. You'll be there. You'll be at the runway in a minute.
Which is so funny because like the whole thing is just like, see, nobody believed in him, but he believed in God and God helped him land the plane.
Right.
Which like literally never happens in the movie. No. It's always an actual person helping him do something.
Right.
He is and, the max amount of help possible from humans.
Yeah, and in real life, I watched the like 20-minute thing. Like he immediately gets help from the air traffic controller, and they're like, "All right, we're gonna help you bring this in."
Yeah,
and then they do it, and he's like, "I mean, he sounds scared on the thing, but they're still like, at no point is there ever any like delay in communication,
right?
Or like him being like, please, what happened to you? Where'd you go?
Of course,
like they're in constant communication with him the whole time, and everybody's just like." Okay, now turn it to the right. Now bring it down. Yeah. And congratulations. Good job. Like, literally, the air traffic guy is like, good job. Yeah.
So you're saying there wasn't a rogue amateur air traffic controller who called the dead pilot's cell phone to get a hold of him to let him know what to do in the middle of a storm?
There was the rogue. There was the
guy.
They
did call a
random
guy.
The friend was real.
They did call the friend. They did phone a friend.
They were
not ask the audience.
They didn't do the 50-50.
They didn't do the 50-50, but they did phone a friend.
But did he call the dead pilot on his cell phone and then one of the girls found it?
No, because they never redirected the plane into a lightning storm.
They're like, we need to send this man to a tropical storm, and that will direct his flight directly into the bottom of the ocean.
Nor did they have him come in for a landing and then pull back up and start the whole thing over again halfway through. Yeah.
That was so funny.
That was really
you
funny texting
when that happened.
Because I just watched the real thing and I was like, well, I guess he lands now. And then they like
Literally, yeah. You fucking have him pull back up. they're like, we're not done.
Yeah. We didn't get the shot. Can we do that one again?
Yeah. I thought at some point he was going to get like in a dog fight with like a Russian fighter jet or something.
It's fucking the Red Baron.
Yeah.
It's so funny. It was really funny too. And one of the daughters was like, look out, what's that? And they're like in the center of the darkest clouds you could possibly find. Like, it's like you'd.
The improvisation in this movie, I guess we should probably explain what happened. They get on a plane. He has to fly back for his brother's funeral.
Yeah.
After some weird, like, horny scene between Dennis Quaid and...
I wanted to talk about the horniness as a separate point. So yeah. Let's continue with the plane.
So basically the entire movie is that they have to fly back to Naples from Louisiana because his brother dies.
I think they're at the funeral. So they've made it to Naples. I believe they're flying home.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Louisiana. Yeah. They're flying home from the funeral.
Exactly.
And yeah, the pilot,
Louisiana.
They keep like, they made like this thing where like everybody who's close to Doug White dies of a heart attack. And then literally the pilot in the seat next to him. And it's so funny how they're like, he's like in a bad mood and his wife is like talking to the pilot, and then the pilot's like, hey champ, why don't you come check out the cockpit with me?
Yeah.
Like, it's such a funny portrayal of like the infantilization of like a middle-aged man.
when they start
playing with like, oh, I'm gonna play with the big toys now, the airplanes and the cool trucks and stuff.
Yeah, it's like Trump sitting in the front of that the 18-wheeler and honking the horn.
That was so funny.
Yeah, don't worry, pilot, buddy. We're all here for you. Are you okay?
Yeah. Yeah. Also, like the pilot taking him up to the cockpit was totally setting up the airplane, you know, Zucker movie joke of hey Doug, have you ever seen a grown man naked?
Yeah.
You ever been in a cockpit before? You ever been inside a Turkish prison?
The pilot dies of a heart attack.
Yes. Literally, he's like, God, I just wish that, like, I wish that no one else around me died of a heart attack.
Yeah.
And then it's like, literally, this guy has, like, the Midas touch where anyone he touches just fucking, they're like fucking, like, ventricles or whatever you call it, just, like, immediately swell up.
And the rest of the movie is...
really
16
is.
People repeating the same things to each other over and over again, drawing out a 20-minute incident into about 75 minutes.
It was pretty funny that Spirit in the Sky When I Die song, I don't remember the title, the name of it.
Yeah, it's called Spirit in the Sky. Yeah, that's a famous
song.
That
was playing when the plane was taking off. Jeez, so
that was amazing.
That was in the trailer too.
Amazing. Yeah, they placed some actually popular music, which, you know, that's expensive nowadays, even old songs. So like they just used a distinct amount of budget to get the original Norman Greenbaum Spirit in the Sky. They also licensed Leonard Cohen's Hallelujah. Yeah. And they did the thing which it's funny. It's not that song is anti-Christian, but it's not a Christian song.
No. Yeah. I was like reading about it to double check to be like, I'm pretty sure Leonard Cohen did not write this as a Christian song.
It's not a
song.
Praise song.
Yeah.
It's not a praise song. It
probably
references,
why they didn't use
it references
his version,
the Bible.
Though.
Well, certainly.
And it references the Old Testament and specifically like a sex scene in the Old Testament.
Right. It's just funny. I mean, certainly they weren't going to use his version, but it's just funny that like there have been re-recordings of that song just as a praise song. Like,
yeah.
You know, the intention of that song has just completely morphed into like, oh, you just sing Hallelujah over and over again. So therefore it becomes a praise song.
Yeah.
And there's the DK rap modification of the song too. Conglaluya or whatever.
I've never heard that.
I feel like you played that for me.
It will be in this episode.
Here we go.
Donkey Kong.
You know him well.
He's finally back. Some tail.
His gun can fire in spurts,
and he can shoot up.
He's bigger, faster, stronger too. The leader of the DK crew,
the bat photon, performing hallelujah,
hallelujah,
hallelujah.
I really loved how the actors had to improvise in like the pilot or in the flying scenes, and just how shitty of a job they did. Now they left it in the movie. You could just tell whenever people like started talking and they were just like randomly pointing out things and talking over each other. Yeah. Where they would be like, oh, is this there's that switch right there. And like somebody immediately is like, yep, that's the switch with the, for the plane. And then, I've never been in a plane like this before. It's a pretty big plane. Oh yeah. Well, we fly planes like this all the time. And, my favorite was when Heather Graham and Dennis Quaid are flying out to the ocean and they're like, what do you see? And they're both like, the ocean, it's just a blue ocean, blue sky, yeah, like, blue everything. And like the shot, you can tell, was just like done in front of a green screen.
Well, I don't see land. All I see is water. Are we out over the ocean?
You see the horizon, Terry?
No.
I cannot see the horizon. All I see is baby blue sky and baby blue water.
I don't see land. It's just the ocean. Are you sure we're going the right way?
Look out the window on the left. You see
it's all blue. Just everything is blue.
Yeah,
I just love that.
Well,
shit.
That's how you know they're really good actors, because a normal person would have said, "Oh, I only see green.
I see a green screen.
I see a green screen, and below that, a green screen.
I see a camera. I see lights."
That's how you know you've got the best. This is A-list talent in your Christian movie. They're saying, "Oh, I see the green ocean. I see the sky. Yeah. I see blue." They literally are like a blue sky over a blue ocean under a blue sky.
Yeah. God damn.
That was awesome. You know what, actually, you know what, the way that they dealt with real versus fictional stories in this movie, it reminded me of I'm Not Ashamed, the Columbine movie, because it's so funny when these Christian inspirational things are based on real people, because yeah, everyone has to be given this like struggle, like the friend, like Carrie, who was the guy in Connecticut.
Yeah.
Who like helped, you know, he is like having domestic issues with his like girlfriend or wife or whatever. Yeah. And she's like, you never listen to me. And I'm just like, where do they get the shit from?
This is such a, yeah, this is such a wife movie too. Like husband and wife movie.
Such a wife movie.
It's so crazy.
Oh my God. I wrote down so much. I literally wrote down woman moment in my notes like twice.
It's truly like one of those, it's like that Christian thing where they're just like, your wife is supposed to be like, my husband is my best friend.
Yep.
And I do everything he tells me to, and I'll always be there to support him. Yes.
There are literally two instances of wives being co-pilots, like emotional co-pilots in this movie.
And literal co-pilots.
And which, yes, turns into literal co-pilots. So here's the two moments in my notes when I wrote down, I wrote down something and then wrote woman moments. the first is when the woman comes up to the one air traffic controller at the bar, comes up to him, sits down, and is like, you're trying to sleep with me, aren't you? Yeah. I was like, cool. The second is when they're in the, Carrie and his wife are like in the garage, and she starts like bringing out all these fucking pieces of wood, and he's like, what are you doing? And she's like, I'm building you a cockpit.
It's a King Air 200.
And the cockpit probably looks like nothing he's ever seen before.
Probably.
What are you doing?
Building you a cockpit.
So fucking
she just
ridiculous.
Starts like fucking
something
building.
I'm pretty sure he never needed.
No.
Like, and they like made it a
what
huge
is she
montage.
Doing? I was like, what yeah. the fuck? He has 20 minutes.
Yeah.
She's like fucking built like makes an entire like Lego set of an inside of an airplane for also, him to like visualize.
Also two incidents of what the first one where yeah. the first one of these like, oh, I can't let this happen again, is when they're flying into a lightning storm.
Yeah.
And Heather Graham says to Dennis Quaid, who at that point he is like, we're going to die. And she goes,
what you gonna say?
She literally says, we've been through bigger challenges than this and we've gotten through them. They're flying a plane into a lightning storm that neither of them has ever flown a plane before.
Watching this alone, I literally said out loud, no, you unequivocally have not. This is without a doubt the biggest challenge that your marriage has faced.
And then another character, Carrie, when he's on the phone with Doug, goes, he says, my family was in a similar situation and I couldn't help them. When he's like explaining why he wants to help these people. Right. And
And I looked it up, and the guy, the real life guy, his dad actually died as a pilot on a plane crash.
Wow.
Oh, wow.
Like a plane exploded or something.
Crazy.
Yeah.
Wow.
So well, I was just
it did
like,
seem weird to me to have him tell the family that. Like, I've been in the situation before. They died.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, because I don't know the guy's real story, but the movie made it seem like when he said that, my brain literally went to he also tried to talk a plane down from the ground, and the plane contained his entire family in it, and he did it wrong, and his entire family died because of it. That's
he and his partner didn't build a DIY cockpit fast enough.
Yeah,
she couldn't build it.
Well, he had to do both.
Yeah.
So that guy, I guess the true story is that one of the air traffic controller people was like, oh, I have a friend who's an expert in these planes. I'll call him and I'll just basically tell you where all the switches are.
Yeah.
Because I would imagine that the planes are all pretty similar in theory. It's just like a matter of it's like when you're used to driving a Ford and you get into a Toyota or something. Right. And you're like, why is the fucking shifter over here?
Right. Yeah. You fly one plane, you've flown them all.
Yeah. I just imagine somebody parallel parking and then having an air traffic controller and their friend tell them how to start a Prius
or
something.
I do believe that there should be an air traffic controller system for cars. When you're going anywhere in your car, you should have to be in constant communication with a centralized command system.
Yeah.
There should always be like people barking orders at you. Like, you're going to need to merge sooner than that.
I feel like that might help things.
Maybe.
I think that would
It would create things. A lot of jobs. That's for damn sure.
Yeah. That's what we are here. Job creators.
Yeah, that's what we are. Yeah, we created work for ourselves. That's for damn
sure. We should
sure.
focus on that instead of more public transit, I think.
That's a really good point.
Yes.
Instead of building high-speed rail, let's install many ground traffic control centers all throughout the United States that and every car has to be on a radio system and like check in with people, and like imagine everyone in the cars being like Delta Western Niner Jazz Tango Zulu Bravo. It's like everyone's doing ham radio all the time. That would be so fun.
Yeah, it could be like a good gig economy job too, where you just like have an app and you can like hop on and do it to help people here and there throughout your day when you have time.
Oh, that's fun. Yeah. Or it could be like jury duty. You could like have to serve. It's like mandatory. You get drafted into it every couple of years.
Yeah. But you get a free car. But gas and cars are free because it's like a co-op thing.
You get like a fake version of the car that you're instructing. It like sort of looks like the car in the inside, but you really just like put your iPhone up and like
your wife has to build it for you.
Yeah.
If you don't have a wife, you're out of luck. If you have a wife, then she'll build it for you. On the spot.
Maybe we should just be the surrogate drivers. Like this is how Tesla auto driver, like the autopilot in Tesla works, where there's actually just like a person at, Tesla who's driving a model of the car built out of 2x4s and a little steer. Why did the guy have a steering wheel in his garage?
This guy's a freak.
Yeah, she just managed to find everything to build it. Like, what the fuck did that? Did we see the finished thing? I was like,
maybe
no. It made no sense. It was very strange. Yeah.
I'm pretty sure there's like 200 switches and buttons in this cockpit that you have to like suddenly. She's got a bunch of. She's like soldering thimbles together and like hot gluing a bunch of jacket buttons to a 2x4 to recreate this cockpit.
One of the biggest laughs out of me in the whole movie was when she was like, I'm building you a cockpit. I was like, no, you're not. Like, what do you think you're doing?
So good. How many times did either of you keep track of how many times somebody said the first instance was the 13-year-old aviation enthusiast Donna Braley, who, as far as I can tell, is completely made up for this movie.
Yeah.
It is a little girl who is in her bedroom and she wants to be a pilot, so she listens to like air traffic controller radio.
Yeah.
And she is just listening to this whole incident go down and sort of like being like, oh, you have to do this. And then moments later, which another fucking insult to the air traffic controllers that they're like slower at their job than a 13-year-old. Yeah. And she invites her friend over and they like listen to it. But she's introduced by saying, since I turned 13, things that I don't see, I don't believe in. And she says her dad, the Easter Bunny, and the boogeyman.
Yeah, right.
But I think the implication was like, oh, you can't see the wind. But which, yeah, another thing, like for a pilot in training, ostensibly, you would want to believe in at least, you know, the wind.
Sure, yeah.
You can't see that.
Right.
But it was like the setup for like a few other times in the movie where somebody would be like, you have to trust what you can't see. Oh, you have to you have to believe in things that you can't see. And literally, Kari on the phone, when he introduces himself to Doug, says, I know you can't see me, but you have to believe in me. Which is like, he gives this like weird little spiel that basically, spiel that basically like sets him up to be like God, which I found to be kind of sacrilegious.
Yeah.
In a Christian movie.
It was strange
movie.
To say after he's been talking to people on the phone for like, I don't know, seven people in a row too. Like, okay, yeah, I won't stop listening to you now.
He was like, I know I'm not there. I know you can't see me, but you have to trust me. You have to listen to me. Very strange.
Like, okay.
Yeah.
Go on.
I'm all ears. I got nobody else to talk to. Yeah. Right.
I think that was right around the same time another air traffic controller said, it's a suicide mission about getting them to land. And it's like, it's not. It's just like a crazy thing that's happening.
Yeah. I don't know. It's just, this whole movie was just such a weird like disaster thing where people are just artificially like, no, why are you trying?
Yeah.
You need to give up immediately.
Yeah. It was awesome.
Well, I wonder if that was partially why they had the young aviation enthusiast say, I'm going to be a pilot one day. And her friend asks why. And she says, because one day after science class, Mr. Jones told me I couldn't. Like that was supposed to be like, you can do it despite the odds.
Right. I just imagine like a teacher like stopping a girl in the hallway completely unprompted and be like, just so you know, you'll never be a pilot.
Well, I wasn't thinking about being one before now. But now
Mr. Jones, a random other believing in what you can't see. I like when they're praying on the airplane and Heather Graham's character says, Lord, send your angels to hold up the wings of the plane and help us land. And I imagined like the three giants from like Majora's Mask coming and like grabbing the plane out of the air. That was pretty cool.
Kari, when they're actually landing the plane, him like they made up some bullshit thing of like, oh, you have to not be touching the steering wheel to get the plane to
right.
land.
Right. They were like,
and he's like, let go, Doug.
You gotta let go.
Let go.
Let go.
It was like, I don't know. I feel like I would be so insulted if I was a part of this.
Yeah.
And I saw this movie and I was like, you're literally giving fucking God all the credit. Like, I was there the whole time.
Yeah.
I landed the plane.
Right.
Yeah. The God thing makes sense if they just like wring their hands and are like, that's that. And then they like, the plane lands.
Yeah.
You know, like if they're just like huddled together praying and then the plane just lands.
No, I love that. I mean, I agree. And you sort of said this earlier, Julian, but yeah, it is really funny how like, I mean, you could certainly as a Christian make the argument, like it is a blessing that all of these like trains people were like helpful and knowledgeable and like able to use their like hard work and skills to land this plane. But yeah, when you rewrite the movie to be like, the dumbass air traffic controllers actually made us drive directly into a lightning storm. Yeah. It was only by the grace of God that like
it was only until I around. Let go completely
literally
of all
just
the controls
closed my eyes.
And let God take over that the plane landed.
Yeah. Yeah.
Jesus take the throttle or whatever they
do. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. How many times did somebody say autopilot during this thing?
That was
like, that might have been, if you did like a word cloud from the script, I think autopilot would be like gigantic in the middle.
So just some other random aspects of the movie that I really liked. One thing I liked about this movie, horniness was normalized in this movie.
Yes.
I liked genuinely how horny this movie was. You know, I've complained several times on the show about how a lot of new media is like asexualized or desexualized or whatever. In this movie, Heather Graham was literally like, you can try my special sauce. Like,
yo,
I was like, this is a freaky ass broad. She's like talking about her special sauce.
Oh, in the plane. That face she made after too. Cause like Dennis Quaid's character, Doug White, he's like, he's feeling a little down 51 minutes into the movie. He's not sure they're going to make it. And she says, you can do this, and you sort of have to if you ever want to eat my barbecue sauce again. And then makes this like wink, wink kind of smile face. It's like, oh, my God.
So nasty.
I know. Well, and early on in the movie, she was like, she makes like a sex joke at her husband. And her brother's like, oh, you can't say, you know, blah, blah, blah. And she's like, don't say that around the kids. And she's like, where'd you think the kids came from? Which I think is fine. I think it's great. I was literally happy to see it in this movie. It's one of my favorite parts about it. These guys were having sex, y'all.
Yeah. Something about equating like girly cum to barbecue sauce is just so nasty.
They're really nightmarish. Oh,
man. You got to see a gynecologist if that's going on down there.
Oh, it was crazy, too, when they joined the Mile High Club, when they thought they were going to die when they're in the storm. They just closed the cockpit and fucked.
Yeah. Yep.
Mom, Dad.
Do you know where the EpiPen is? Not now, girls.
Your father's got to give me his EpiPen, if you know what I'm saying.
I did think the pilot said when he was doing like the thing, this is blank, blah, 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 taking off. I thought he said the name of the plane was Air Kink. But he said
Air King. Oh,
said King Kink Air, but he said King Air.
King Air. Mm.
But I mean, it might as well have been called fucking Kink Air. The amount of horniness in this movie.
Also, something I thought about with this movie. I think that drinking was like pretty normalized. I feel like drinking is pretty normalized in Christian pop culture now. Now I know that the end of the movie, you know, we meet that character. I actually can't remember his name, but it's sort of implied that he has, well, not sort of, it's definitely implied that he has a drinking problem. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the movie, he says, you know, he goes back to the bar, but it's just to close out his tab, or so he says. And he asks the woman out for a drink. Instead of asking her for a drink, he asks her out for coffee. So it is sort of implied that he's like trying to move past drinking and be more sober in his life. That being said, most of the movie, there's like people pouring themselves like liquor and like beers and stuff like that. Yeah. You know, I just sort of thought that like it was interesting to see how secularized Christian culture has become. This is the devil's influence, y'all.
Yeah.
Don't trust it. Do you think the Cristiano brothers would have had people doing like drinking gin and whiskey in their movie, unless it was like literally like them drinking it while looking haggard behind the wheel of a moving car and being like I hate God. Like, yeah. You know, they would never do something like this in their movies.
I mean, the air traffic controller who had allegedly a drinking problem, he did at the end sort of give up.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, it was definitely implied that, but and I still
it
thought
seemed that like the, that. Yeah. Oh, that was the right choice to make because he had.
That's true.
It was important to not. So yeah, it was more like a message about, oh, you can drink as long as you're responsible,
right?
Versus,
and this would have been another good point for the Zuckers to be involved, like having their air traffic control guy who's always like, looks like I picked the wrong day to quit huffing glue.
Yeah,
great joke. There's also let's not forget an airplane. Like, that's when I developed this drinking problem. But his drinking problem is that he always misses his face when he's trying to drink and he's always getting himself wet.
Should we just review Airplane?
Yes. I think we basically did.
Because I
really think this was the Christian version of Airplane. I thought it was fantastic. Any other random moments from this movie that were funny before we review it? I just wanted to point out that at the funeral scene, like the background music is this like soaring, like multi-part harmony by like a clearly like a black praise choir.
Yeah.
And then it like zooms in on the church and there's only like six people in the choir singing. I was like, there's no way in hell that six old people, some of them were black, like some of them were white, but still I was like, there's no way in hell that like six random senior citizens in a church are singing this like intricate layered harmony gospel version of Amazing Grace. Like, that was really funny to me.
God lifted up their voices.
Well, that's for damn sure.
Oh, you know what we didn't talk about in the movie that was really funny? Like, when he does die and they realize it, Heather Graham, like, tries to give him CPR, like, from the standing position. It's, like, super weird.
I didn't even notice that.
She was, like, trying to do chest compressions, but, like, from the side.
I didn't notice that.
Maybe that's not what it was supposed to be, but it was, like, a weird, some weird direction about, how to try to save him or something. I don't know.
That's really funny. Yeah, she's probably improvising that too.
Well, I loved it.
Yeah, this is the whole, this is like a Christopher Guest movie. Everything was improvised. They just had like an outline.
You know, I guess again, a big themes in the movie, you know, definitely the importance of family. The nuclear family must stay together at all costs.
Yeah.
You know, believe in what you can't see. And of course, that the power of the white suburban family will break all boundaries, will break all obstacles.
And that two plucky kids will help re-explain the plot every few minutes.
Yeah.
Including when she brought down her, she had like those model planes that were up in the ceiling. She like pulled a rope, then they popped down. Then she pulled off the plane and just threw it and it smashed to explain what would happen to the plane if they stopped abruptly.
Drama queen.
Like, this really didn't explain anything, too. I mean, that really did feel like they filmed all that after the movie to like be like, we got to have something for little kids when they see this movie. This movie felt like how like morons when they watch a movie, like morons producers or executives when they watch a movie are like, nah, we got to dumb it down for middle America.
Yeah.
Because they're too stupid to understand anything. But really what they're saying is like, I am too stupid to understand this.
Right.
Because, really, I mean, they were just constantly repeating everything. They literally just did the movie over again.
Yep.
Because they were like, we still have 40 minutes left in the movie. We can't have you land this early. So they're like, there is wind at the bottom. So you got to pull back up. Yeah.
I was going to say, if flying a plane is so fucking dangerous, these shits would never get off the ground. Yeah. I know things happen, but damn.
I did read an article that said because of climate change, there's like more and more like weird wind tunnels that they can't predict, mm-hmm. which is why turbulence has been like there's more like horrible turbulence is happening more frequently because... Wow. Of climate change.
Interesting.
Which is terrifying because I am already scared of flying.
Yeah, I don't like to fly.
Our flight to North Carolina that one time was fucking really bumpy, wasn't it?
I sort of remember it, yeah.
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 You guys should fly to North Carolina again soon just to see if that was just a North Carolina thing or...
Yeah, we should do an experiment. Any excuse to come back. There was a flight. I can't remember what flight I was on. I think I was coming back to LA from visiting my parents where like I literally like the whole flight. I was like, please just let us land. Like, please just let us land. It was so scary. No one else seemed scared.
That's the thing that always gets me. No one else gives a shit. I kept shyly
looking around and everyone was just like looking at their iPads and shit.
I'm always like, I wouldn't get up and just be like, do any of you realize what's happening right now? We're going to die.
Well, should we rate this movie?
Yeah.
Let's rate it. I'm going to give it a Delta Whiskey Niner out of Niners. A perfect Niner out of Niners. Rip-roaring good time for the whole family. Wow. Very stupid. This is the kind of Christian movie I like to see.
Yeah, I agree.
So silly. I was dying laughing the whole time.
Me too. I was having a great time.
Well, I'm giving this a... chili cook-off award-winning movie, The Blue Ribbon.
Wow. This filmmaking hobby has led you to get a perfect film from Boys Bible Study. As for me, I love this movie. I thought it was a reasonable length. It was like an hour 40, which is like, you know, we couldn't cut it down to an hour 30, but still, I'll take it given the slogs that we've had to sit through.
You could cut it down to 20 minutes if you really wanted to tell the real story.
And appropriately,
well, 30 minutes,
I would
keep the 10-minute EpiPen sequence.
Yeah, I'd keep the EpiPen.
And the chili cook-off was good.
Okay, 35 minutes.
Appropriately, I would like to rate this movie 20 out of 20 minutes because, oh, wait, boys, we didn't get enough time on this podcast. Can we go back up and do the ratings again?
podcast in another thunderstorm or whatever.
Yeah, let's just start at the beginning of the plot and work our way back to where we are now so we can get those minutes in. But yeah, really enjoyed this film. I would say there is still hope for fun Christian blockbusters to emerge and through streaming numbers that we are unable to verify become, you know, potentially the top movie on Amazon Prime by their own metrics or reporting. I mean, Is any of this true? Can anyone independently verify this? Maybe you can. I don't know. But, well, to all who listened to our review of On a Wing and a Prayer, thank you very much. If it's your first time here, please check out boysbiblestudy.com, where you can listen to all of our public episodes and subscribe. And if you really like what we do and want to support, we encourage you to check out patreon.com/boysbiblestudy, where your subscription of $5 a month or more will get you access to all of our bonus episodes. But many of you already do subscribe, and we very much appreciate it, especially our generous patrons on the $20 tier, our patron saints, Nicole, Marissa, Jeff, Jane, Kara, and Rhett. And our outro music is Oh My God by Mary. So from all of us here at Boys Bible Study, myself, Ash, my co-hosts, Scott and Julian, our friend in Connecticut, Carrie, who helped us land this podcast, we would like to say, peace be with you.
And also with you, Delta Tango. Hallelujah.
Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned. I feel your love in me, it's coming from within.
Oh my God.
My devotion is so unwavering. Divine emotions when you enter me. Every day.